It's really good, those talks we had this morning, because of course what we're doing is we're programming water. So, you know, Veda was showing us how any of our intentions or dreams or anything is being picked up by the water. And so really what we're doing in all the methods I use, homeopathy and sort of bark flower remedy methods, we're just being clear that we have an intention that we want to put into the water, and then the water does the action. And so it's really the water that we've empowered is then sort of talking to the water in the plant and in the soil. And that intention's then being carried into the plant. So that's the mechanism. But the question really is, what are we wanting? You know, once we're going, okay, we've got the method of being able to transfer an intention to something to impact on plants. But the question is, what is it that we want to empower? And then later, how do we achieve that? But the big question is the what. And there's various methodologies that we can use when we come to this question of what. And, you know, the obvious one is the biodynamic preparations here, because we've got these nine substances that are all working on those energetic activities that Ian was talking about. He was talking about the human having these four bodies. And so the question is, you know, what are they? And what's the reality of those? And, in biodynamics, we're basically saying those four bodies are the sort of basis for reality to occur. And so if there's a pest or a disease, then there's an imbalance in those bodies. And so rather than killing the pest, we can alter the arrangement of the bodies. And this is what, for me, the biodynamic preparations are. They're these things that influence the energetic bodies. And we'll talk about that more in a while. And in a sense, that's what biodynamics gives us, is this opportunity to understand what these bodies are and how we can work with them. Now, I appreciate that this isn't talked about very much in biodynamics. And the way that biodynamics is being presented most of the time with something like cowpan pit is that all of the preparations being put into the compost heap or put into the cowpan pit, and they're just being applied. Mm. Now, what happens if you've got a circle and you pull all of the strings at the one time? You just go to the middle. And so that's what cowpan pit is attempting to do, but we've got to remember it's in cow manure. So it's actually 500. It's on the 500 side of the scale. And so there is a danger that you can't just use cowpan pit over and over and over and over, because you're going to go to the 500, which is going to go to the leafing, which is going to kill all your fruit and then all your ripening.
Interesting.
So you still need your 501 with cowpan pit. But the point being that using all the preparations, like in the compost heap, all the time, is you're just achieving balance. Now, balance is good because, you know, we work from a central place. We're in a much more stable position. But we're still going to be knocked off balance with the climate. And so that's what's going to lead to your powdery mildew, will lead to your insect attack.
Rust.
And rust and so on. And now what are you going to do? Yeah. And a lot of the biodynamic solution becomes sulfur, copper, neem oil, these sorts of things as the solution. And it's like, well, if we can use the preparations in a more creative manner, then we can use them to do those alterations. And so, you know, that's a discussion we can have. Now, the other array of things that we can use, of course, is agrohomeopathy. And there's this book here called Homeopathy for Plants, and it's Christiana Maute, M-A-U-T-E. And that seems to be the sort of local Bible for agrohomeopathy. And like normal homeopathy, this is, I consider this like an external system. They go, oh, we've got a problem. We've got a predator. Let's potentize the predator and put it on there, and that goes. So it's very much about symptoms. We've got a symptom, we've got something that'll either create that symptom, so we neutralize it. To me, they're not solving the energetic imbalance. So like peppering, you know, where we'll get the skin of a possum and we'll burn that, and then we'll apply that ash, we get rid of that species. So when we did birds, you get rid of the sparrows, in come the waxeyes, get rid of the waxeyes, in come the fantails, get rid of the fantails, in come the next one. So we're not addressing the imbalance. We're getting rid of the problem, and at the same time, there's not a lot of consciousness going on with that. You know, it's like, okay, we just use this to do that, problem solved, you know. Whereas with biodynamics, we're actually being asked to think a bit and put in a bit of effort to come up with a solution. And because, you know, I haven't written a book on biodynamic homeopathy yet, so you can't just go and get a book and read this stuff. It's still coming. But there's lots of places that you can get all the information, like Eugene Talisco's done this wonderful series of books. What's it called? Zoology. Well, they're zoology books anyway. And they're just little zoology books. And he outlines this whole animal kingdom in the language of these four bodies, and how it's organised, so that, you know, if you're looking at an insect, what is the different groupings in the insect? How does that relate to the nerve sense and metabolic and rhythmic and these sorts of things? So there's plenty of information in the biodynamic literature to be able to formulate the answer. Let's put it that way. So agrohomeopathy is one of the options. The next one I put there is called the chemical elements. And this is some work I've done over the years. And that's the easy way to show you it right at the moment. And so the top picture is really just looking at...
Would you like me to hold this?
Oh, this will be all right for the moment. But down the bottom here, I've reorganized chemistry. And we found the energetic activity of all of the elements. And so what I do now is we put that on the ground and focus it to north. So we're using the Earth's magnetic field to organize within a circle. And you know, all cultures have worshipped circles for thousands of years. And we can put a bottle, a little glass bottle of water, on any spot, and we accumulate the energy of that spot, and then we can go and spray that and we get effect.
So how did you know which one
to
use?
Yeah. I worked that out
before.
Yeah, and I'll show you in a minute how we do that. Okay, other ones, cell salts, they're a pretty obvious bunch, you know. There's four cations: sodium, potassium, magnesium, and calcium, and three anions, phosphorus, sulfur and chlorine. And so there's a system there that we can identify energetic activities, but there's also just knowledge and information around, like Andreas Belt mentioned sodium sulfate works on curling leaf beetles.
You know,
sulfate. So, you know, you can just use your cell salt to do that. So, we'll talk about the Adoran remedies
in a minute.
But they're a group of these remedies that Steiner gave, and they're minerals. So they're sort of like the BDAL remedy is quartz and iron sulfate. And he cooks that up, he bakes it, and then they grind that up into a powder. And it's used for migraines. And what it's doing is, migraines from Steiner's point of view is that this metabolic activity is becoming so strong that it's pushing up into your head and pushing out. And so this quartz and the iron pushes it all back down again. Mm. And so, now, interestingly, this is the same picture of powdery mildew. And so it's highly likely that beetle could be used for that.
B-I-D-O-R.
So these beetle remedies, I've sort of put them together with the biodynamic preparations. There's 9 biodynamic preparations, 9 beetle remedies. And so there's a way of looking at how they can work together. So they're an option that's available for us. Now, of course, bark flower remedies, and there's thousands of bark flower remedies, and so if you could work with those, that's an option. Now, in the, I don't know if you've got it in your book, but I've done some work on these Walter Russell subatomic essences, and again, they're in a circle, and you can take them out of the circle, and they're just another range of these energies, and especially when it comes to bacteria and viruses and fungus, I think those elements are able to be worked with for these energies. And then, of course, we've got radionics, which is endless, and there's various ways of doing that. You can get essences and put them into the machine and radiate them out, or you've got little cards of various elements. There's a whole technology there that is useful both for potentizing and beaming. But the problem with beaming is that once you turn the box off, the beam stops and the pests come back. So there's a bit of an issue there. And I've got to say, with the biodynamic preparations, when we've done them homeopathically, they work on average about 3 weeks and for pests and so on. And then the pests will come back again. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's... You know, I'm a big one for... You've got to get your soil right. And that, I mean, by minerals... And then the structure, you know, your clay sand balance is really important, your humus and carbon is really important, and then your minerals. You know, if you want a long term easy life, get that as good as you can, and a lot of your problems will disappear. Because otherwise, with the biodynamic preparations just by themselves, it's like, here's your plants and it's falling over because the minerals aren't right. And we come along with the preps, 3 weeks, fall over, pull it up again, fall over. Mm. Whereas if you get the soil right, then you're going to be solving a lot of those problems. And then it's your climate. You're really just dealing with climatic problems is your alterer. You know, things dry out or they get too wet or, you know, something like that. So these are the sort of what.
What's the BDANZ? What is the BDANZ? Is that a brand or what did you say?
Well, all of those are just called these odorant remedies.
Oh, they're the odorant. Okay.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
No, these are Steiner's. And there's a little book by a Dr. Wolf, W-O-L-F, and he runs through and talks about them and all that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've just sort of put them in the order related to the planets. That, you know, we can talk about that more.
Okay.
There's a whole thing going on there.
Right, okay.
But it's a way of organising the information so that we can get handles on it. Mm-hmm. You know, that's my sort of process.
Okay, thank you.
Is that we've got all these big ideas and these big concepts, but somehow, you know, we've got to be able to put them into order and see how they're working.
Okay.
And Steiner's really good at this,
yeah,
by the way. Mm-hmm. And yes, while he's encouraging intuition,
yeah,
he's also encouraging intelligence.
Yes.
And
yeah,
you know, he does talk about the way things work in patterns. You know, he's talking about the threefold process,
right,
of nerve sense and rhythmic and so on. But he's also talking about the sevenfold processes that happens with the planets and 12-fold processes. You know, so he is using these patterns the whole time. And it's like, why would he tell us these stories?
Mm.
Like, if you look at the agriculture course, there's two main stories. There's one about the bodies that Ian was talking about, and then there's this other one about the cosmic and earthly substance and forces. And so it's very easy to read that just as cosmic and earthly, and the earthly is 500 and the cosmic is 501.
Mm.
But when you really read into the story, and you can see in the eighth lecture, he gives this picture of the animal and its cosmic forces, earthly substance taking place in the head, and earthly forces and cosmic substance taking place in the belly. Now, once you've seen that, it's all the way through the whole of the course. And I've done several attempts at showing that. And they're on my website, all for free. And they're in this book, as in these pictures as well. So, you know, this is this conversation that it's like, why would he tell us this? If he just wanted us to work with intuition, which isn't, it's commented on in the course, but the rest of the course is telling us this technical manual of how these forces are working. And how, you know, if we want to grow potatoes, we've got to be really aware of the sand and the clay, because the sand is going to be drawing in all of these cosmic forces into the ground, and the clay is going to be releasing them and sending them back up again. You know, now why would he tell us that if he didn't want us to use that information? And you know, the point with fungus, when we come to the sixth lecture, we're looking at this idea of those rots, you know, too much rain in the spring and it's all really wet and we get all this wetness and up comes this moisture out of the ground and, of course, is then around the plant's leaves, and so therefore all the fungus that should be living in the soil comes up into the leaf realm and we get fungus there. So what we've got to do, and he makes this comment, you know, it's too much vitality. We've got, and that's really weird, that we've got all this vitality, it's causing a problem.
Mm.
Now, if we look at it just as a push and a pull, he says, oh, well, here's equisetum, we can push it back with equisetum. And in lecture 5, when he was talking about oak bark, he's saying, well, we can go up and we can grab that etheric and we can pull it into the ground. But when we start thinking, well, clay is the other part of this story, and you know, if you've got this big watery bubble that's sort of pushing back this upward movement process, and so that if we want to push that back down, we can do that there, but we also want to push this up. We want to get that sort of urge for that plant to go to seed back into gear. And so this becomes an essential remedy for rots, this clay. And, you know, so that's where I'm saying we've got a technical manual there in front of us, and we can use all that information to come up with solutions, which personally I think is the biggest gift of biodynamics, is our potential to develop solutions. And we're not really doing it at the moment. So, you know, so anyway, getting back to our subject here, the big question is this whole point of what are we trying to do? And as I say, we're wanting to balance these bodies. Now, what are they? What are these things? And I think part of, you know, what Rudolf Steiner talks about is as above, so below. So if we really want to know what's going on here, we've got to look around us and see what's the big picture. And what we come to is the reality of astronomy is that, you know, the big picture is that we're living in a galaxy, and that this galaxy is full of these stars that all beam in force at us. And so there's billions and billions of stars within our galaxy, but then look at all the other galaxies and all the other stars. And so we get this image of the fact that we are sitting in the middle of this big energetic matrix right here, all these stars beaming through us the whole time. So this is the energetic fabric that we're working with. And that this is a reality. These star forces are a reality. And the issue is that they're sitting there going like this for billions of years.
Yeah, right.
You know? So these are constant streams of force. And Paracelsus was one of the early people who said every species finds its source in a star. And so he's giving this image that a star is sitting there beaming into the Earth, and out of that comes a rose. And, you know, Steiner makes this comment about the star forces and how they're necessary to keep a rose being a rose and not becoming a berberis. You know, he makes that comment. Well, this is the star forces, and he made the comment that we have to call these things something. And so he called them the spirit. So that's what spirit force is, stars. It's not anything woo-woo. It's actually a star force that's real. And we then come, you know, just sitting in here somewhere, is this guy. It's our local star. But around our local star, we've got all these planets. And, you know, a good image of them is really that they're just compost heaps. Because the star, you know, is spinning, of course, and it's drawing in energy in the poles, and then it squirts it out along these horizontal planes. And the planets are coming along and sucking it all up. And so we take on 100,000 tons of cosmic dust a year onto the Earth. So that's why when they dig up dinosaurs, they have to dig a long way down because there's cosmic dust.
How do they measure that?
Well, they do all the carbon dating and stuff like that. But, you know, the Sphinx, when they found it, it was right up to its head. And apparently, it was buried by cosmic dust. It wasn't so much sandstorms and stuff like that. It was just this. And they say most of the dust that's in your house that you dust off is cosmic dust. It's not coming off the paddocks. It's actually just coming through the atmosphere. So
always wonders.
Keeps coming.
It sure does.
And the point is, that's what we're living on. We're living on a compost heap. And this guy in the middle here is a nuclear reactor.
You know, there's big stuff going on, and stuff's being created and made and blown out, and we're just picking it all up. And so when we're looking at this astrology, then that's the metaphor we have to see, is that our spirit that Ian was talking about is not only looking at our consciousness and everything, but it's having experiences. And so, like right now, you're having an experience. And so that will stay with you for a period of time. So it's like a T-shirt. You've got the T-shirt. And so this is what our astral body is. It's just this massive accumulation of all of these experiences our spirit has had over all of our lives. And so that's this subconscious that he was talking about. Down the bottom of the picture, that's all of these personality traits that we've accumulated through our lifetime. And I'd like to suggest that you can see this in your birth chart, in your astrology chart. And so you don't have to be surprised when you meet it in meditation, because you can already see it in your birth chart. And you might have difficulty recognizing it, acknowledging it, accepting it, but it's there. And if it's there, keep looking. And so that's what the astral body is. It's this energetic body that your spirit has created out of all of its experiences. And then, of course, we come to the next layer. Well, the next layer we come to is the Earth, actually, because Steiner has this story about these three worlds. And he talks about the spirit world, the soul astral world, and then the physical world. And so that's the Earth. But of course, out of the Earth's activity has come oxygen. So the atmosphere of the Earth has been created by the life processes of the Earth. And the same with calcium. You ever look, these hills here are all calcium, and you go down the middle road, there's a quarry there, massive, you know, I don't know, 1,000 feet deep. These are all come through a living organism. All the calcium on the planet is the residue of a living organism. And the oxygen's the same. It's all come from life. And so these are the two things that support life, calcium and magnesium and oxygen. And so this is this fourth world that Ian called it that. He said the etheric is the fourth world, and that's where it's come from. So that's the first, second, third, fourth. And so this is this life body that he talks about. This is the one that puffs us up. It actually does this. And so that's our, I think he was calling it life energy or feeling good or whatever. So these are the four players, and they've all got physical bases. So we're not asking you to believe anything. We're just saying, look at what's real. Look what's in your environment.
Were you saying first, second, third, fourth, so Earth is the first, S, then the second?
No. First, second, third, fourth. The spirit, you know, the galaxy, the stars are where it's all coming from. And then the solar system comes next, and then the Earth, of course, organises. And then out of the Earth processes, we get this life body that, 4 billion years later, we can survive in. You know, so that's the four players. And as I say, there's nothing to believe here. This is what there is. And so what we're doing is we're just playing with those four. Now, we can look at them as if a building site. What do we need if we're going to build a house? We need an architect to draw the plans and to fit within the rules of the council and to get it all. And then we have to give it to a master builder who's going to sort of organise for the whole project, giving it to the workers who's going to do the job using the physical wood and nails.
So what happens if you take out the architect? You know, the master builder can just do whatever he likes. What happens if you take out the master builder?
Chaos.
The workers just sit down and don't do anything.
Sure.
You know, so this is the metaphor. And so, you know, we need the spirit to be incarnated properly so that we can keep things heading in the appropriate direction. And we need the astral body to give us the activity and the motion to keep things moving. And what I find fascinating is when we're looking at the stars, they're fixed. They're just stationary. Yes, they're moving, and over thousands of years they'll change, but in our life, they're fixed. And water, if you just leave water to sit, it'll just go stagnant. It needs something to move it. And the only moving part are the planets. And so that's what they do. That's what the astral body does. It gets things up and moving. And this becomes this whole role of equisetum, actually, when you really look into equisetum and what it does, is that... Rudolf Steiner gives these stories about the kidneys and how you get shrunken kidneys. And the kidneys are these places that process our astral body. So all of our psychological dramas and emotional traumas are all sort of dealt with our kidneys. Now, if we can't do that, if that outside influence is too strong, then we start getting psychological sort of traumas going on. But it pushes out our internal astral body. So this world process comes in. It's like a poison that we can't digest. You know, if we take a tomato, for example, some people can't digest tomatoes because of the alkaloids that are coming from the deadly nightshade family. And so they come into our body, and for a healthy person, they can overcome that and they can digest that. But if you can't digest that, then that alkali becomes a poison. So that's a world process that's coming in, and it starts disturbing the internal processes. And so this is what happens with trauma. Disturbs the kidneys, pushes out the astral body, and the internal etheric that's depending on the astral body to keep it moving actually starts to go sluggish. Mm-hmm. And thus the kidneys shrink. And so what equisetum does is it brings in the internal astral body, which pushes out the world astral body and then starts activating the internal etheric to get the kidney process going again. So that's his story. And so it's a really good picture of what we want, that we want the astral to keep the etheric active and keep it moving. So we've got to have this interaction of this etheric and astral activity. But we need the spirit to keep the direction going.
And saying that, if we're using equisetum to keep these processes moving and that sort of thing, and we've come into a season such as winter, which we're in now, which is when everything is down, relaxed, and that sort of thing. Should we be thinking about equisetum through the winter as a maintenance thing to keep that whole thing going?
Well, have you got a problem, would be the question.
Not really, not this time of year.
That's right.
Yeah.
So I think it's you know, where is he talking about using it? He's saying when we've got this big watery process coming out from the earth, then we need to be able to push that back. And so he's saying we need to be bringing in this astral activity, because this big watery process is sort of pushing everything off. So we need to bring the astral back in to contain that world etheric in this case.
Yeah.
He's saying the disturbance is coming from this overly active world etheric. So if we stimulate the internal astral, then that will help to balance that process. As I say, we want to also use oak bark to pull this thing back down as well, and we also want to push up the clay to get through that water. You know, because that watery process, in a normal plant growth, what we're looking at is we've got this process that comes out of the ground in the spring, right? Oof. Well, that carries the calcium. Calcium winds on the silica. and the silica goes up the plant and takes all the other cations with it. And so we need that. And what's happening is we've just got this big watery bubble without the direction, without the carrier. So it's just this big, and we get rocks. But if we can actually get that sort of male, come on, wrap the calcium around and take that, then it's got direction. The etheric has direction. So that's part of a healthy plant. Question?
No, I didn't.
I was just
going to
ask if that's how like people get quite fungal at particular times. Because when I noticed lately, I've been noticing it with the plants and animals and people at the same time. Is that a similar way to reduce that?
Well, you've got two lots of funguses. You've got your rots, which is what we're talking about. And then you've got your dry fungus, which is powdery mildew, rusts, and those sorts of things. And they're coming from the opposite direction. They're coming from too much light and warmth from above, as opposed to too much moisture from below. So you actually have two different solutions for fungus. And they can be put in the one bottle, I've got to say, but you do have two different. And Steiner mentioned...
If there's been too much light, I would have thought light would reduce fungus.
Well, it brings powdery mildew.
Mm, it does.
And rusts, and then insects are all coming on that too much light.
You get rust, and we get the rust in the garlic starts coming usually around October.
Yeah, same.
Right.
November, when, yeah. Usually when...
Same. It's usually been wet, then it dries out. And that's when the rust comes in.
It's
been wet and then it dries out very quickly, and that's when
what
the rust comes
in. October.
It's the same with powdery as well.
Yeah, that's right.
You need the wet before you can get the dry to get the rust.
Yeah, the imbalance gets pushed. The change is the deal. Now, while we're going past here, I should just say that Steiner mentioned cinnabar, which is mercury sulfate, and I think beetle. So I've been mucking around with cinnabar for some time, and it does seem to work. But this year I'm going to have a go at and get cinnabar and beetle for powdery mildew
and all rust.
Well, yeah, those the light and the warmth from above.
I'm keen to go have a try on my garlic.
Well, you can buy them from Valada. They come as powders.
Oh, and what's it called again?
Cinnabar?
Is that the mercury sulfate?
Mercury sulfate.
Oh, okay.
Now, what we've done here is just that picture that we just had. We have a spirit, we've got the galaxy. We've got the galaxy sitting in over here, then the solar system, the atmosphere, and the Earth. And so that means you've got the spirit ring, the astral ring, etheric, physical, duality. And then, because of course, we've got the earth, but then we've got this realm of male and female before we get a physical body, right? So that's why we have this ring of duality. That's our male, female. There's your physical body, there's your etheric body, there's your atmosphere. So we've got that just as a picture. Now, Steiner talks about what happens when these bodies become active and we get movement, because this just is galaxy solar system. They're just there. But everything's moving. And once we get movement, then we get polarity taking place. And so what happens is that we have spirit and physical, and then etheric and astral across the middle here. And so we get this picture here, which was in the 1922 October medical lectures. And so we get this picture here of all these different bodies. And so Steiner talks about how the bodies interact with each other. They're not just pushing each other, but they're coming into. And so we're getting the astral body coming into the etheric and organizing the etheric and so on. And so how do we conceptualize that? And what happens is if you get this picture here and put it on top of that picture there, you get this picture here. And this gives you all of the different interactions of all of the bodies. It's a really simple thing, but it's an incredibly powerful outcome.
And so spend a bit of time with that picture and get that, because of course that's what tells us about the energetic activity of all of these chemical elements. And so at that point, if we want to stimulate the astrality to help with the etheric, we can sort of go, well, here's the internal etheric arm and here's the astral ring, so we can use that point there. But we've also got this point over here where we've got an astral arm and an etheric ring there. And so we can look on here and we can say, well, that point there and this point here. So what we get is strontium selenium. And so we can use that for insect control, because we need to balance out the astral and the spirit.
Yeah. How would you use that chart? So start with
an
insect. You've got army worm.
So it's an insect.
Yeah.
Right?
So where's it?
It's in the ground.
Good question.
Okay. So it's in the ground.
Army worm.
Yeah. So we're going to be looking at a potency of between 20 and 30.
Yeah.
Because metabolic system, 0 to 10. Rhythmic system, 11 to 20. And
so
nerve
sense
system.
Metabolic is 0 to 10.
Yeah. Then the rhythmic system is 10 to 20, and the nerve sense system is 20 to 30.
Mm.
And of course, it's an armyworm, so it's in the ground, so we're going to use a potency of 20 to 30. And it's an insect, and it's a worm. So in the insects, you've got an egg, a worm, a pupa, and an adult. So physical, etheric, astral, spirit. So a worm is the etheric part of the insect. So you're looking at some imbalance in the etheric. So this would say what's happening with your humus, what's happening with your soil structure, what's happening with your calcium, your magnesium. That's that mineral level, mineral dose questions. But ultimately you've got this problem where this etheric activity is being disturbed by an astral activity. So we want to balance an astral etheric activity. And so this is where we go. See how these are world bodies, internal bodies. So it's an internal problem, you know, because they're eating the plant. So we'll go, here's an internal etheric arm, here's an astral ring. So here's a spot here of how the astral and the etheric. And we go over here, here's a spot here, astral, etheric. So we look at those elements, and that's your strontium seleninate. So you get a little bottle and you've got to line this up to, now you can use the pictures in the book, and you've got to line it up to north because we're using
the
Earth magnetic field is activating this, and
so we've got that picture somewhere.
You've got it in
the
book.
Chemistry, right?
Yeah.
I just got a question. Why would the army worm...
Water violent.
Yep.
Yeah.
Does the army worm come in the physical, though? You said it's actually just in the etheric.
Well, because it's a grub.
Life stage. It's a life stage.
So because it's a grub, it's the etheric part.
Right.
Okay.
Could you say those again? I know you're talking about...
It would be the physical.
They're all physical parts of it, but because of the life stages, it's going through the physical, main physical part is the adult form.
The pupa, or the flying part, and then you've got the
adult,
which can be beetles.
Which is, what's that last one?
Oh, spirit. It's a spirit. So if it was a spirit, if it was a beetle, like brown beetle, bronze beetle,
which was?
Then you'd be sort of looking more into this spirit realm, you know, because there's more heat tied up with that being. So instead of, see, this is grubs through here, this is flying insects, this is the beetle insects out here. At the end, there's
the very last Glenn's medicine wheel on the back page.
This one here.
Oh,
on my website, you know, Glenopathy website, there's a whole bunch of videos. So on YouTube, just put my name in YouTube and there's a whole bunch of videos in there, and you can look at the chemistry videos. There's
one called The Nature of Nature, and I was just talking with a friend, and we talked a lot about insect attack and stuff like that. And it's just charged up water.
Yeah.
You know, it's just how do we put the intention, and then homeopathy is just a delivery method. You know, we're just using the water and directing it through the potencies so that we can have something to put on the plant, carry the effect. You know, it's just a mechanism, really.
And so you put the water, you suppress the water to do with the, you know, whatever stage of development the grass grows at.
Yes.
And then you put it on flame on the chart and direct it to
the No. You collect the element, you know, the strontium or the selenium, or you use the biodynamic preparations, you know, on this chart here. Have a look at that picture there, and that's the picture that's telling us about the preparations in regards to the energetic activities. So, anyway, there's the big picture for you to mull over you know.
So just to finish finish that example if you don't mind.
Yes.
Got the army worm,
we've got that, what's the next step? Well, you put it into stuff like army worm is classic. I came across it in maize. You know, so they basically they'd sow the maize in, and then as soon as it came up, well, we actually sprayed it straight after they sowed the maize. And then the maize comes up, and like 5 days later, it's okay, it's too big for the army. So that's what we did in that case. But what we generally do, probably 500, 503, 502 mix, because we're stimulating the etheric and harmonizing the astral. So, so we just spray it as early as possible, basically. Yeah, and then when you get some green tissue, do it again.
Yeah.
So that might be 10 days later, and that should be enough by that stage. But, you know, as I say, 3 weekly, like white cabbage butterfly, we spray every 3 weeks through February, March, and it's really bad. So that generally does it. Well, if you have to do it every 3 weeks, generally you do it a couple of times for three weeks apart, and then that's generally enough.
Lynn, does this your details on your website?
No, it doesn't actually.
Can we just put that?
Just my name. Just put my name in.
Google knows
now.
Google knows.
It was good,
even though we've heard it before.
It's always good.
Thank you.
We're just here on speaking time.